once again. We're lesson number 6, and this is the Gospel of Matthew. And I guess we just need to pick up. Apparently, this is something from last week. You don't put new patches on an old garment. Should be garment there, lest the rent be worsened. Now, what do you think this means? You don't put a patch on an old garment, lest the rent. What does it mean when it says the rent be worsened?
The rent be made bigger.
Okay, the rent there just simply means, in other words, whatever it was that you were patching. And yeah. And the whole idea there, of course, is that I guess this could be one way you could interpret it, because all of this, the new wine and the old wineskin, is all speaking about flexibility and stretching. And let's just say, for example, a lot of clothes you buy now are already pre-shrunk, right? So let's say that back, you know, when I was a kid, your clothes you bought, you'd had to buy them a little bit bigger because they would shrink, right? Mm-hmm. All right. So when you have an old garment, it's already shrunk. All it's going to shrink. So you put that new cloth on there, and it hasn't shrunk yet. And then when it shrinks, it's going to rip. You follow? And all of this is what? Well, let's look at the wine.
Or at least made it look worse, you know.
Yeah.
Because like I say, if you take something that's already shrunk, when you put that on, and if it, when it shrinks, it's just going to
right, just going to rip it. It's going to make the rent worse. Okay. Don't put new wine in old wineskins, lest the wineskins break. And again, the wineskins were sheepskin. And what happened over time is that sheepskins would stretch. It would be the fermentation, I guess, of the wine that caused sheepskin to stretch. And so if the old wine is in there, it's already stretched about as far as it's going to stretch. But then you put some new wine in there, it's going to keep stretching. It's going to go beyond stretching, and it's going to break. And so all of this is referring to what? You don't put the new wine in of the Spirit into an old man, into the old unregenerated man, right?
Mm-hmm.
You put on the, as a new man, you put on new garments. You don't have the filthy garments of self-righteousness. So there comes a time you don't patch up, you just start new.
Amen.
And again, minds must be elastic enough to receive and to contain new ideas. I'm trying to think of many, many years ago, a preacher that, here's what he was saying. He was using the old wineskins, not necessarily referring to the old nature or the old man, but he's speaking about Christians that had gotten so set in their ways that they had stretched as far as they could stretch, that they could not embrace some new revelation. But what he said was that if we would allow the Spirit can make us flexible and can renew. You understand that flexibility, that you can stretch to contain or to receive whatever new revelation. It's so easy when you have, quote, been in the way so many years, and somebody said one time, well, you need, if you're in the way, you need to get out of the way. Well, the way, of course, was the Christian walk.
Right.
But, you understand the whole concept of being in somebody's way. If you're in the way, you need to get out of the way, right? But when you're so set in your ways and you think that you've got it all together and you think you've finally got things figured out, then something else will come along, it'll expand you. It'll challenge you. Okay, the prejudice of a shut mind. See, all of this is speaking about your flexibility, and it's talking about having an open mind. And I'll tell you this, one of the greatest testimonies that I believe you could ever have is that It doesn't make any difference how long you've been saved. Doesn't make any difference how long you have been preaching, that you can still embrace new ideas and you can still embrace new revelations of the Word of God. And I'm not putting any kudos on myself, but I feel like that I have been open to whatever God has progressively done. And therefore, I can embrace truth, even though things I thought 20 years ago that was just absolute truth, I've come to realize, you know, hey, maybe I didn't have the ultimate. Maybe I did not understand. And there may be some things I just have to say, you know, hey, I see things in a totally different light. It's not a real compliment to say that, you know, you have steadfastly stood for, well, it's okay to stand for the truth, but don't be so set in your ways, don't be so stubborn that you're still holding on to old religious ideas that you can't embrace
something new.
New truth.
Right.
Now, this is interesting. Y'all know what chloroform is. It's is that some type of antiseptic?
It was put you to sleep so they could work on you.
Yeah. You know, back a couple hundred years ago, people had surgery without any anesthesia. Can you imagine that? Sir James Simpson had to fight to introduce chloroform. This is in a book. From time to time I'm throwing these book titles out to you, and it may not mean a whole lot to you, but you may come across them. You may come across one down at Goodwill, and you hear me say something about it, you'll probably buy it. But there's another book, excellent book, and I guess I've made reference to this book hundreds of times. It's entitled, None of These Diseases. None of These Diseases. See, and that goes back to the Old Testament where it says, you know, I, the Lord, am thy healer, and I will put none of these diseases of Egypt upon you. And this is by S.I. Macmillan. And he brings out he deals with a lot of practical things that that you can do to stay healthy. And one of the things he said is we're not bound by the law. You know, we're not saved by the law, but the law had its purpose, even the laws, dietary laws. He said, You're not going to go to hell for eating something that was forbidden in the Old Testament, but he said that there was a reason those things were forbidden. See, you can sin against your body. It don't mean you're going to go to hell. Because I guarantee you, there's probably not a one of us hadn't eaten too much, and that's really sin against your body. There's not a one of us that hasn't eaten something that has not really been for your total health. Okay? Now, what you're doing is you're sinning against your body. And what you may do, there may be things that would be bad for your health that you may not go to hell, but you will pay for it, you see, because of the deterioration of your body, the things that we put into the body. Of course, Jesus said, you know, not what goes into a man, but it's what comes out of the heart. So S.I. Macmillan even says that a medical doctor, this has been a couple of hundred years ago, 200 or 300 years ago, discovered that if doctors wash their hands before they interacted with patients, that there's a whole lot less infection. You would think anybody with any sense would realize that. But this particular doctor at that time was ridiculed. You know, there were men who were ridiculed for saying that the earth was not flat. Do you know there's still a flat earth society? That there are some people that belong to the flat earth society? My uncle swears that man never did go to the moon. He said that's just a big joke. Ain't nobody going to the moon.
That's Mary's own.
Yeah.
Joseph Lister had the fight to introduce antiseptics. So I wonder where Listerine came from. Copernicus was compelled to retract statement that the earth went around the sun. And you know who brought much of the persecution against these people that came up with these ideas? Was the Catholic Church. Because they had certain preconceived ideas that they were thinking that this was completely going against the scripture. That for some reason, man thought the sun, came up. They said, we say the sun comes up and the sun goes down. Mm-hmm. It's not true.
True.
I mean, the sun is where it's there. It's in the same place, right? But we do understand what people mean when they say the sun comes up. Okay. Okay, resentment of the new and attempt to pour new things into old molds, old mindsets. Pour activities of a modern congregation into an ancient church building. I appreciate these little country churches that, have all of these old timers that are there. But you wonder, why do you not have young families? Why do you not have kids, that are in the church?
Right. It wouldn't change.
Yeah, and they don't want anything to be any different. Pour the truth of new discoveries into creeds based on Greek metaphysics. Metaphysics is just really has to do with psychic. Okay, modern instruction into outworn language. So here's the bottom line. We're not living in horse and buggy days.
Right.
But do you know a lot of churches are still living in horse and buggy days?
Oh, yeah.
It's time to join the 21st century.
Amen.
And remember this, that God never changes. Our understanding of God may change. And that understanding of God ought to come from having a greater revelation of who He is. And we also need to realize that the gospel has not changed, but the method by which it is transmitted.
Right. Be relevant to your world.
Exactly. I mean, we don't have to worry about having handwritten manuscripts.
We can use the internet. I mean,
And this is interesting. Bishop taught this. I forgot which class, but he... He said that with every major event in history, spiritual event, has always been associated with some new invention that enabled the gospel to be more easily preached.
Right.
Going all the way back to, even further back, but the printing press. The Gutenberg printing press was a phenomenal breakthrough that allowed for the printing of the Word of God. Then in the 1920s, thereabout, radio. Can you imagine less than 100 years ago we didn't have radios?
That's really seems.
And it what blows your mind now, I hear people talk about these phones, what they can do. I mean, it's just incomprehensible. All of this, I mean, once upon, let's see, it took... I may not have my years and quantities right here, but it took something like up until about 1900 for knowledge to double. And then from the 1900s progressively, the period of time it took to double knowledge became less and less. It maybe doubled again in 50 years. Now, I don't know the exact number, but it's almost like knowledge is doubling every year. I mean, can you imagine that? Can you imagine how easy it must have been to be an educated person 500 years ago. It wasn't that much. It wasn't that much to know. I mean, or wasn't that much available to you. So now you had radio. Then you had television. Computers. Well, when I was in high school, there was no such thing as a tape recorder. We had wire recorders. Has anybody ever seen or heard of a wire recorder? It would be a wire that would go from one spool to the other. And then we came up with the reel-to-reel recorders, right?
Yeah.
Then you came out with the little cassettes. Now, cassettes are outdated. Then came your DVDs and your CDs. They're getting outdated.
Fast becoming that way.
You know, I mean, you're downloading
you
all of this stuff onto your...
And Blu-ray. Yeah, and the MP3s. Just download them.
You know what really concerns me is what we have preserved, but whatever means we have available now. Is there going to be some kind of apparatus that's going to be able to retrieve it 100 years from now? In other words, what about your CD now? Are there going to be means 100 years from now that they'll be able to retrieve? If somebody found that CD somewhere...
They're supposed to last that long, from what I understand.
Well, the CD may, but I'm talking about...
Will they
have the equipment that'll play it back?
They have equipment now that you can take albums and stuff and make into CDs.
But you had to have the means to play that album. Well, you know, the phonographs, or phonograph records are no longer the thing, but I guess you can find some phonograph players. And I thought about that. You know, I wrote a book, and I called it The Incomplete Autobiography of William Kenneth Manners. It's a book about that thick that I typed out. Just on one side of the page, 8.5 by 11, had it bound and gave to every one of my kids and every one of my grandkids. And I'm thinking how great it would have been had I had something like that handed to me, you know, about the life of some of my ancestors.
Right.
And I got to thinking, well, is that paper still going to be intact or is it going to crumble, you know, in another 50 years or 100 years? Oh, just some thoughts.
Laminated.
Well, that may deteriorate. Well, think about the old parchments, how they've survived.
Yeah. Some of those for thousands of years.
Yeah. And just some significant healings. The ruler's daughter, the woman with the issue of blood, the healing of the two blind men. Jesus said, "Be it to you according to your faith." I mean, you understand that faith is still important.
Absolutely.
You know, Bishop, speaking about the miracles that we see now is not the result of your faith. In a way, it is. And I'm not saying
they
that to contradict
the faith
him.
To come to receive it.
Yeah, they had to have the faith to believe what he said. You know, that's what I'm saying. In other words, well, the Bible says without faith, it's impossible to please God. Mm-hmm. And it is faith that activates. Now, let me give you another example of why that faith activates. And I understand what he's speaking about when he speaks about the sovereignty of God, that this is a sovereign act of God, that God's going to do it regardless of you. Sure, God can do that. But remember this, God does not always necessarily respond to need. Do you understand? If God responded to every need, there'd never be a need. There wouldn't be any hungry people. There wouldn't be anybody that would die of sickness and disease. There are needs, right?
Right.
But God didn't respond to every one of those needs. So you say, well, what did God respond to?
See.
Well, first, he responded to his purposes, and you know what? Maybe your purpose is in life, and God's not through with you. Sure, that's all in the sovereignty of God. But also, I believe that God responds to faith, and faith is based on the Word of God. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God.
Right.
Let no one know of this, but they went out and spread the story all over the country. There are two theories. Number one is And I don't believe that's what Jesus meant. But have you understand, if you tell somebody not to do something, they'll do it. So let's just say Jesus wanted them to spread the word. He said, don't.
So don't do it.
Reverse psychology.
Yeah.
The word.
But he had a reason, and I believe the reason was that his time was not, yet, and he did not want things to be premature before his time was ready to be offered up. Of course, Jesus cast out devils. I'm going through this very quickly because this is the tail end of the last class. The synagogue was what? The synagogue was the local
meeting house,
the Jewish meeting house where teaching, prayers, Bible reading.
Did they have any offerings at the synagogues?
Probably I'm sure
really.
They did.
Probably some minor ones.
Yeah, they would have to be a means by which that the work of God even then had to be supported.
Sure.
Yeah. Okay, and the synagogues were the place that Jesus started.
Preaching.
And he preached as long as they'd let him. And they'd finally kick him out of the synagogue, and he'd go to the streets. He'd go out and preach from a boat or from the side of a mountain. Paul preached from synagogues. He healed every sickness and disease among the people. Now, again, was it, it was Matthew, wasn't it? We said that one of the guys, let's see, which one was it that Mark, it was Mark that said something like indicated that he didn't heal all, he healed some or something like that.
Yeah.
And then, of course, Matthew and Luke basically said that he healed all. Now, some people interpret this saying that he did not heal everybody that had sickness and disease, but he healed every kind of sickness and disease. Well, that may be true, too. But who's to say that he didn't have 100%? But, again, there were times that Jesus said, I cannot do many mighty works here.
Because he's not received.
Because not received. Because of unbelief.
He can block your own healing.
In fact, he said, exactly. And he said that a prophet is without honor.
Except in his own
only in his own country. Which means, and this is the truth, some of the people that knew Bishop when he was a little boy don't have the respect for him as they ought because they still remember him
as the little kid
down the street. And that's the same way as Jesus. They still remembered him as being the son of this carpenter.
And that's what they say. Is this not Jesus, the son of the carpenter?
And his brothers are among us. And, Okay. I didn't realize that we had moved as far along as we had. It seemed like to me we were stuck on the first few chapters. I've been giving a lot of thought to how we carry out the remainder of the course, and I'll know more about it next week. I had originally taught the book of Matthew in 12 class hours. We're teaching it in 18 class hours now. So basically what I did was to take, instead of 8 lessons, I guess I expanded to 12. But when I taught it before, I didn't finish all of Matthew in that time allotted. And so what I did, I went over into when I taught the Gospel of Mark, I pulled in, 3 or 4 lessons. And here's what I'm thinking. I'm going to go back and find out where I started in that second thing. And that's probably as far as we'll go here, meaning that instead of going over some of the material a little bit later on as fast as we
would have to,
I'm going to try to make some kind of adjustment there. Now, this is in Matthew 10, I believe, that where Jesus sends out the 12. He gave them power over unclean spirits. Now, of course, back in that day, everything was a demon, devils, everything. In fact, up until less than 200 years ago, people thought that everybody in an insane institution was demon possessed.
Mm-hmm.
There may be some that are. But one of the things that came out of what was called the Third Great Awakening, there have been four major Great Awakenings before the 20th century. The First Great Awakening was sometime in 1735, a period of time before the Revolutionary War. The Second Great Awakening was sometime around 1800. The Third Great Awakening was in the 1820s, and the Fourth Great Awakening was in the 1850s, okay? And one of the things that came out of this Third Great Awakening was attention to social issues, such as having a more humane attitude toward the sick or the insane. And it was that period of time where orphanages were raised up. That was a period of time where literature, like tracts, there are a lot of things that came out of that Third Great Awakening. But, and here is the somewhat of a dilemma, and you've heard Bishop make reference to this, that he says that there are some things that are challenging his theology. Now, for those of you who have taken many classes under me, you know what I've taught about the devil.
Yeah.
The devil is real to those who recognize and give. In other words, you can empower the devil. The devil has as much power over you as you will allow. And as much attention as you give to him, the more attention you give to him, the more you're empowering him. Okay? And there is still a reason why there are certain evil things that are happening in the world is because of the work of the devil. And we know that Jesus came to destroy him who had the power of death, that is the devil. It didn't mean that he was destroyed in the sense that he no longer existed. It just simply meant that he made him of no effect. He disarmed him. And again, what a lot of people have considered to be demonology in the past, I think, has just been activities of the flesh. And as Bishop has said, you know, a lot of things we blame on the devil is just ourselves. You know, the biggest enemy is when we look in the mirror. Okay, so we have overemphasized some things and attributed those things to the devil when it's just been the works of the flesh.
Right.
And you don't cast out the works of the flesh. Okay? Basically, in fact, what deals with the works of the flesh is to begin to be more spiritual minded or to begin to be filled. In other words, when you're filled up, it's just like a glass. You take an empty glass, it's full of air. But you pour water into it, the air is pushed out.
Replaced by water.
Yeah. And you think about the water as being the spirit. See, in other words, the air, of course, air is very important, but you can think of the air as in your own body as being representative of anything that shouldn't be there. And then when the Spirit of God is poured into you, when you become filled with the Spirit, then these other things have to go.
Well, Jesus called the enemy the prince of the power of the air.
Okay.
That's how he referred to him. So
that's the kind of air I'm talking about, I guess.
Yeah. It's we replace with this, as we have the Spirit come in, his influence is pushed away.
Exactly. And there's different kinds of air. And I say different kinds of air. Air is really breath. I mean, when you're speaking about the breath of God, it was air. And we've got to have air. We've got to have water. He commanded them to heal the sick. And the one requirement was you go only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. They got the first shot, didn't they?
Yeah.
Now, listen. The plan and purpose of God was not that he came to just restore Israel, and Israel turned it down, and so God turned to the world. Everybody follow me here? But what he intended was that the house of Israel be restored, and from that restored house of Israel, the rest of the world would be touched. Okay? But you see, a lot of people say, well, you know, God was only interested in the house of Israel. That's not true. But Jesus' mission was to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. And then it became the responsibility of the apostles to take the gospel to the nations, right?
Yes, sir.
And the first one that we have record of is Peter, who went down to the house of Cornelius. Cornelius was a Gentile, right? Mm-hmm. And then, of course, the church at Jerusalem calls him and says, what is it you're going down to this Gentile? See, they were saved. Those early Christians were saved. But they had not yet received the revelation that this gospel was for all of the creation of God. Okay, we could go into a lot of that.
Real easily.
The mission was to the Jews, and that had to be fulfilled. And another thing is, these disciples were so ingrained and were so schooled in the Jewish way of thinking that maybe they weren't ready to preach to the Gentiles. I mean, even after Paul received the revelation that God had sent him to the Gentiles, there was still contention in the church in Jerusalem.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, the kingdom of heaven, we've spent a lot on this. The kingdom of heaven is at hand. The kingdom of God is a society on earth where God's will is as perfectly done as it is in heaven. You may want to make a note of that.
That's an overlap, just like some other things.
Yeah. Maybe we'll just make a note of that. It may be in your manual there, but put a little star beside it. The kingdom of God is a society on earth where God's will is as perfectly done as it is in heaven. A society on earth. The kingdom of God is a society on earth
where
God's will is as perfectly done as it is in heaven.
That's good.
So the kingdom had come because Jesus was the king of the kingdom. Okay, we won't. something else that I was going to bring out. All right, we'll get to it. Jesus said, I send you as sheep among wolves. What is the scripture refers to wolves in sheep clothing?
Yeah.
Is that scripture?
That's actual scripture.
Wolves and sheep.
Beware of wolves who sheep in sheep's clothing who come amongst you and seek to devour you.
They disguise themselves as the sheep, but they're wolves. There's a young minister down in Atlanta, I won't call his name, draw any undue attention, who wrote a book, Sheep in Wolves Clothing. So what do you think the implication of that is?
One who looks rough, maybe a rough exterior, but inwardly they are a child of God. They are one of his sheep.
That's a good try. That's a good shot. But think about what did it mean for wolves to be in sheep's clothing? It was so they could infiltrate the sheep and have an influence on them, right? Mm-hmm. So if you have sheep in wolves' clothing, that meant that they were disguised to make infiltration into the world. You follow? So it's really just the wolves in sheep's clothing were out, of course, to deceive. And the sheep in wolves' clothing are not necessarily to deceive, but to gain entrance, to bring entrance and to have influence. So you can have influence for good just as much as you can have influence for
Matthew 7:15, beware of false prophets which come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravening wolves.
And what scripture is that?
Matthew 7:15.
Okay. All right. Now, Jesus did not promise any of us a bed of roses. Would you agree?
Absolutely.
There's a price to be paid, really. I mean, you know, we say Jesus has paid the ultimate price, but how do you understand that there is a price that we pay, and that price may be turning our back on the things that we once loved, or to lose people we thought were our friends.
Family.
And it may even be alienation in the family. He said, you will be persecuted in the synagogues. Where do you think the most of persecution has come from? It's come from religious, organized religion, and from the so-called nominal church. True persecution does not come from the true church. Okay? Because the true church is made up of the saints of God. Now, you may have some well-meaning people that don't have any evil intent, but they call themselves a guardian of the truth. And so they think that you're teaching some kind of false doctrine. They feel like they're obligated, see, to stand up for the truth. And as a result, they may not be recognizing that you may be speaking the truth, and so they will find themselves persecuting you. You know, Hitler supposedly claimed that he had certainly wasn't honorable, but in a way, I guess he thought that he was fulfilling. Well, let's take the KKK, okay? If you listen to the philosophy of the KKK, they say, you know, we stand for God, we stand for the truth, you know. They may be standing for what they perceive to be God, but God is no respecter of persons, and God is certainly not a discriminate right. God. He sees equality of all men, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I guess what I'm saying is that even religious people can be good people. They may have good intent, but they may be misled. But persecution, Paul persecuted the church, did he not? But he represented religion.
The religious system, exactly.
They will bring you before the magistrates. Now this is what's interesting. He said, take no thought what you will say in that hour, for
the Holy Ghost will give you what to speak.
Now, this is kind of pretty cool. It's interesting how different people have a perception of ministry. And there are some who are not really into the Word. They don't have a disciplined Bible study system. And they will say things like this, that I don't need to prepare a sermon. I don't need to have an outline. Well, you may not need it, but I'm going to tell you this. If you're going to feed people on a regular basis, you better have something of substance. And that might mean that you have gone and you have dug out something. See, by inspiration, God can give me a thought. See, by inspiration, He can cause me to feel in my spirit what to deliver to the congregation on Sunday. But then I take that inspiration and I begin to study to put together scripture, you see. But there are people who call themselves spiritual and said, well, you know, I'm not going to take any thought. I'll just get up and, you know, whatever God's...
Let the Holy Ghost give it.
But what Jesus is saying here is when you're called before the magistrates. He didn't say when you get up to preach. We ought to be a workman to show ourselves approved, a workman that needs not to be ashamed, but rightly dividing the word of truth.
Now, it is true, though, that you can prepare all week long. I'm sure you've had this happen. And get up there, and he'll pour something else into you to speak.
Yeah.
Even though you've got something ready.
I understand that, but let me just put another slant on that. Don't you think that God knows exactly what's going to happen?
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So maybe what we thought God put on our heart may not have been what God really put on your heart.
Might have been yourself.
Yeah. And I've been in that situation. I have prepared, and I would have said, well, you know, God gave this to me. Well, he may have given it to me, but it might have meant for it to be some other time, some other situation. So God knows ahead. He knows 3 weeks ahead what somebody's going to need. In other words, if I were invited to speak somewhere, I may start preparing my heart and maybe begin to hear the word of the Lord weeks ahead of time. And when I get to that place, what I deliver is exactly what the people need. Mm-hmm. I had the opportunity this past Sunday to, was it this past Sunday or a week
Sunday
ago?
Sunday before last.
Yeah, Sunday before last. You know what I'm going to say. Yeah, Pastor DC invited me to come speak to the Spanish congregation. And I really had somewhat of a tough time really getting what I thought was a real clear mind of God. And I just finally told him, I said, well, you know, the only thing I can just really keep focused on is just simply the disciples' prayer, our Father which art in heaven. And so as I began to minister, there were things that, you know, came out of that.
Yeah.
And Pastor DC said that it was a right on word, that it was confirming so many things that he had already been instructing, been teaching Spanish congregation.
Wonderful.
Okay, you will be hated for my sake. Even your friends and family may turn against you. You're not any better than your master. If they persecuted me, they'll persecute you. We don't know what persecution is, really.
No, we do not.
If you really... I say you, any of us, if any of us really came out and declared what we really felt in our hearts that we may be restrained in, you follow me? And I believe that. I don't believe that preachers always preach everything that they know or everything that they understand.
Or believe,
because
right.
There's a time and a season, and there may be certain things that God gives a minister that you could choke somebody to death, spiritually speaking, you know. You can get choked on a piece of meat, right?
Give them too big a one.
Yeah. And I guess what I'm saying is that we may not be persecuted. Let me give you an example. And in a way, this was a persecution. You know the sermon that Bishop preached